about this. When people do what is right, it shows they're righteous. And then he says, when people keep on sinning, it shows they belong to the devil. Child, if you're practicing sin, you belong to the devil. That's what he's saying. And he calls us children. And it gets worse. Who's worthy? Who is worthy to take Holy Communion? Who is worthy to come to the table of the Lord? He says the devil has been sinning since the beginning. And then I look at myself and say, you say everyone who practices sin comes from the devil, is a child of the devil, and I continually sin. What's that make of me? Very unsettling thought. The other day I went to have a visit at the dentist. Who likes to go to the dentist here? Anybody? Oh, a couple of hands. So I went to, you actually have the right motive to like to go to the dentist. Something really cool though, I went there Wednesday and they cleaned my teeth and everything, nice, cheerful person was doing all that. And then, and he comes in, to, he went to, she called him in to look at a questionable tooth. And he said to me, after he asked me a few things, he said to me, "You're such a happy guy." And he said, everybody in the office said, "Look at this guy, he's always happy when he comes to the dentist. Isn't that great?" And I thought about it, said, man, what a great thing to have someone. If you can get a dentist to say that you're a happy guy, come in his dentist chair, something's going on. What a great thing to hear. But the reality is, he doesn't really know me, does he? He sees me at that particular moment. He doesn't know me like my family members do. I can assure you, my family members know that there are moments when I'm not a happy dude. And they've seen me at other times. My happiness with the dentist, you could say it was kind of a farce. It wasn't representative of who I really am, is it? It was just a part of it. It wasn't fake. It was, wait, I was happy to be there. I'll tell you in a minute why. But it's, he surely knows we have our own dentist. So, point being, one of the greatest problems we have in religion is that we have to appear holy. We have to appear like something that we may not be. If I tried to put on a smiley face, he would have seen right through it. He would know. You know when somebody... My wife says in Portuguese, she uses a phrase, she says, sorriso amarelo. It means a yellow smile. I don't know, Spanish, maybe it's the same thing. What a yellow smile is, it's a fake smile. It's that smile you put on when you're trying to act like you're happy. But everybody can tell, they look at it, it's just, that's fake. Appearances don't work. We don't need to appear holy. Follow what the Bible says, and the Word of God, what the Word of God teaches us, and what the essence of what Jesus is showing us and teaching us. We don't have to appear holy, we have to be holy. And the problem is, the appearance is just the external, exterior, it's not what's inside. So it's visible even if I'm not good inside. When we accept Jesus, especially when we accept Jesus like this, it's not enough to accept him, but we have to also exude the awesomeness that it is to know Jesus Christ. It's something that really should, it's visible. And if you bear witness and you tell the great things that have happened to you, this is something really amazing. It helps people. We grow spiritual when we tell somebody else about the great things. But we're also compromising ourselves spiritually as well. If I say, look at what Jesus has done to me. If I give witness to somebody and say, look, you know, this is what he did to me at work. This is how he acted in my life. I got a lot of things I can talk about, great things he said. There are moments you're feeling so close to God, you can witness something, you can tell him great things, and one day you're not feeling so well. And one day you've sinned. You come into church maybe, and somebody comes up to you. Maybe you actually gave your testimony up front, and that person comes up to you. And you look and you say, oh, no, I really don't feel like it. I don't feel well. I guess I need to look well, though, don't I? To appear well, to appear holy, it's not a Christian thing. This is a Pharisaic thing. It's something which It's something that makes it so that we don't judge ourselves in the way that we really should. It is sort of an avoidance. It's not something that is that we are taught to do by what Christ has given us. Let's take a look at, continue on in 1 John. Are we still in chapter 3 here? Let's see if we can get 1 John 3, verse 9. Those who have been born into God's family cannot make a practice of sinning because God's life is in them. So they can't keep on sinning because they are children of God. He has said before that the enemy has sinned since the beginning, right? We saw that before. And he said, those who have been born into God's family do not make a practice of sinning. We got that right here. That's even worse. Because I'm a sinner, and I am a repeat offender. I do the same sins over and over again. Where do I fit in that? That doesn't look good at all. You're saying that those who do this are a child of the devil. Is that the way it is? So if we go back, let's take a look at 1 John. Go back two chapters. 1 John 1. And we'll look at verse 5. This is the message we heard from Jesus and now declare to you. God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. Verse 6. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God but go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth. And it just keeps getting worse. Because we speak a lot about fellowship with God, and if there's one thing we've heard about, it's this, that fellowship with God, it's the way out of everything. It's the way we take care of our problems. It's the way that we are sanctified. It's the way for God to work in our hearts. It's the way for us to be saved. There was a pastor who was asked one time, if you had 5 minutes to preach a sermon, 5 minutes, the world is going to be destroyed, and you have 5 minutes to preach a sermon, what would you preach about? He didn't skip a beat. He said, you know what? I would preach about John 15, where Jesus says this, John 15, 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. That is what the pastor said he would preach if he had 5 minutes. What does it mean to bear fruit? It means that the thing that's inside is externalized, to externalize what is within us. When somebody looks holy, puts on the appearance that they're holy, worried about looking good, it's like a wolf wants to be a sheep. You've heard about a wolf in sheep's clothing? It's a metaphor that we use at we talk about a wolf in sheep's clothing. Sometimes it might be the enemy sneaking in among our ranks, and they're concealed, and they come in to do evil, and their whole plan is evil. That's not this wolf. This is a different wolf I'm talking about here. This particular wolf wanted to be a sheep. He didn't just want to sneak in. He wanted to be a sheep. And they preached him, and they said, if you want to be a sheep, you have to turn yourself into a sheep. And he didn't feel any transformation. He didn't feel any magic. He felt nothing, but he wanted to be a sheep. They said to him, now we have to be baptized. And they baptized him, and he went and he put on a sheep's skin. He put it over himself. And he went to where the sheep were. But he's still a wolf. And he went to the pasture, and he tried to eat the food that they were eating. He went to eat some of that grass. It was kind of nasty. He really didn't like the grass that much. He's trying to do sheep things, and he wasn't quite getting it. And to be honest, he's looking around, and the sheep were looking pretty tasty. And he tried to make sheep sounds. He tried to, like a sheep. And it came out, ba-ooh. He still was a wolf. It wasn't working right. The days went by. And he was getting so tired of this, he couldn't eat that grass. He wanted to eat some fresh meat. He was hanging around the sheep. He could not stand the topics of the sheep's discussion. He's just not into it. They were kind of dumb. He was smarter than them, and he couldn't help himself. And one day, he tossed aside the sheepskin, and he ate the nearest sheep. Devour. He was a wolf. He still was a wolf. He still had a wolf's heart. And that's what John is saying. It's not enough to to be inside the church. It's not enough to say I have fellowship with God. It's not enough to get up early and pray and say, I get up on my knees really early, because to say that if I say I'm in fellowship with God, but I'm still walking in the darkness, then I'm lying. That's what he's saying in the prior verse. It's a lie. I'm not practicing the truth. If I really am a sheep, then I'm a sheep. If I'm a wolf, I'm a wolf. If I walk in the light, if we walk in the light as he is in the light and keep fellowship among us, the blood of the Son purifies us from all sin. So this actually leads us to another idea here. And that is the idea of this sort of an external test. There's a few of them. This is one of them that you can see if you're in fellowship with God. Anybody can think of a way to tell us if you are in fellowship with God? I guess you shouldn't have one to look at others, but looking at yourself, ignoring everybody else. What is that? And that is this. If you're in fellowship with God, you are going to be able to maintain fellowship with others. And what is fellowship? It's love. What a difference that makes. I'm going to tell you about my dentist again. He told everybody I was the happiest guy, always happy when one went there, but it wasn't my doing. I showed up at his office 4 months ago. Now, I had a great dentist I liked years ago, and he did a terrible thing to me. He retired. And so I went 7 years without going. It's like, oh, man, it's getting worse. This is getting really bad. Every year, it's more afraid to go, more, who knows what's going to happen. My dad said to me, yeah, go to my dentist. You'll like him. Gave me his name and number. And I got an appointment, it was November, and I went to see this guy. And I was nervous, I was afraid to go find 50 cats. I told him, I said, I think I'm going to need like 4 crowns and this and that. And he looked at me and said, why do you think that? And immediately he put my mind at ease. He was talking to me about my dad, and we were chatting about this and that. And there was something about this guy. I looked at this guy, and I knew right away. I liked the cut of his jib. He was just really a great guy. And there was something, even the next time and the next time, and the real difference was, this man loves his patients through and through. He exudes love. He exudes care. When you're talking to him, you're not talking to some fearsome person with scary tools. You're talking to somebody who really, really cares. He establishes a relationship. So why do you think I was smiling when I went there on Wednesday? That's the reason. It's because of the relationship. Just somebody who is honest and pure and who really cares. And it was obvious he was just, that was just shining from him. So then we can do the opposite, of course. We can have problems. We always do. Those are the easiest things to do. A church leader came to a pastor once and said, and this was a guy who was an elder, people really respected him, liked him a lot. Sharp guy, church leader. He was a very spiritual individual, and people went to him for advice. Well, he went to the pastor and said, you know, I'm having a problem. And the problem was this, there's somebody in my department, and I got to tell you this, I don't know why, but the guy doesn't like me, and I pray for him. I've been praying, but for some reason he doesn't like me. And the elder goes on and he says, and he did something the other day that was just over the top. I couldn't put up with it. And it's just, and I prayed, but you know, at the end I finally realized I can't do this anymore. And the elder said, Pastor, so I decided I'm just going to let it go. I'm not going to confront this individual. I'm going to let it go. And that's going to be that. And I'm going to change departments. And well, what do you think about that? And the pastor answered. What do you think the pastor answered? What would the pastor say about that? Some of you know exactly what the pastor would say. Somebody, or some of you know. Others may not. What the pastor said was, well, he said, you shouldn't have said this to me because this is the answer I'm going to give. And answer is the answer any pastor will give you. He said that we have to look at Matthew 18. And that actually is the key for everybody here. Write that down. Anybody who has a conflict with somebody else, pastor will always point you in this direction. Chapter 18 of Matthew. So what this really says is if you have something against your brother, you should, you must, you are required to go and speak with him so that you can have fellowship with him. If you can't have fellowship with your brother, how can you have fellowship with God? And the gentleman said, do you really think so, Pastor? And the pastor answered, I don't think so, I know so. That's what the Bible says. Amen. This is what needs to happen. And this happened that morning, and then about 3 in the afternoon, this guy found the pastor at the church and said, you're not going to believe this. I came in early, I had some work to do, and I bumped into him. We went into this little office in the corner, and we sat, and we talked, and we talked, and we talked. And we prayed together, and we hugged, and we are good. Thank you, Pastor. And he was so happy. He could not believe how well this worked. It was not easy. But this is what came when he did the right thing. If I say I'm in fellowship with God, I'm in fellowship with my brothers and sisters. Now we can go the opposite direction. We can be not in fellowship. You know what happens if you have a problem with somebody and you're not talking to the person about it, but you're talking to somebody else about that? If I have a problem and I speak about it with others but not with the right person, what's going to happen? I say, you know, Brother Joe, you know what he did. You know what's going on, but what he's up to. Well, he did this, he did this, he did this. So if I talk about somebody behind your back, I am reducing their influence on another listener's, in another listener's lives. The next time they interact with the person, they are not going to pay attention. So let's just say I say something really bad about somebody to you. And then that individual stands up in church one day to contribute to maybe a testimony, or maybe they're preaching, or maybe they're simply giving a prayer or something. You're going to be thinking, he's not who he says he is. I know who he really is. So if I say something about another person behind your back, I'm undermining their influence they have on the listener, the person who I'm talking to. So it's a dangerous thing. It's something that, it's something very harmful. And that's why it's not biblical. I have to talk directly to the person I have the problem with. That same pastor received an email one day from somebody who had issues. Wasn't the same guy. This was a different one who was in a department. He said, I'm leaving my department. You know why? I'll tell you why. I told the leader because I'm overwhelmed. I got a lot of work to do, and I want to spend more time with my family, but that's a lie. And I'll be honest. It's because I'm upset with him because he did this, he did that, did this. He did X, Y, and Z, and possibly some Q, too. Well, that's not a relationship. I don't want to have to deal with a relationship like that. And there was some person who once said, I can't stand discussing my relationship with my wife. I can't stand having a discussion like that. It makes no sense. It's a waste of time for a simple reason. I don't need to, because I'm always right. What a great attitude that is. And that's really the situation this person was in. And the majority of people who don't want to resolve a relationship issue, it's because they feel they're totally right. I don't need to, because I'm right. Pastor replied, that's not the way to have a relationship. You have to speak to him. You know what? You're going to tell him your list of stuff, and he's going to tell you a list of things that you did, and you got to listen, because it takes two. Well, that guy never did speak with another person. He simply built up resentment. Bitterness in his heart. And you know what happens when you build up resentment and bitterness in your heart? It really hurts somebody. It's really hurtful to somebody. And you know who that somebody is? It's you. Because it's not hurting the other guy. He doesn't even know. It's hurting the person who's got it building up in their heart. And the person who's doing that is carrying a terrible load on their back. Let's go to another verse in 1 John. We'll go back there. We'll go to see if we can get 1 John 1, verse 7. But if we are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. He's saying that if I have fellowship with others, because I am in fellowship with God, and walk in the light of God, and the blood of Jesus will cleanse me. But does that mean that if he's saying this, if I don't do this, then the blood of Jesus will not cleanse me? Still, sounding troubling. I feel less worthy. Now let's look at the next verse. This is interesting. Suddenly something changes. If we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. Now we can only see this verse on here, but if you look in your Bible, it's a disconnect there. It's kind of like John was writing, and he took maybe he had a quill, or maybe he was scratching on a tablet or something, and he lay it down, and he went off somewhere to get a snack. Somebody else came by. I'm going to do my Angry Birds pig imitation. I'm like, I'm going to add something, and he's never going to notice. And they put in this extra line that doesn't match the lines before. All the lines before it are telling you. Maybe we can go back. Andrew, can you bring it up to for one verse before? These kind of verses. If we're living in the light, then so on and so forth, we have to do all of these in order to be cleansed from sin. We have to be great in order to be cleansed from sin. But then we get to the next verse, and it's telling us, but if we say we have no sin, we're fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. It's a disconnect. But John is really saying here, he's saying, wait a minute, listen to what I'm telling you. He's saying, I'm not speaking to people who don't have sin in their lives. I'm speaking to people who have sin in their lives. And he's saying, I'm not speaking to people who will not sin again. I'm speaking to people who are going to sin again. Pay attention. So he goes on. We'll take a look at verses 9 and 10 here. But if we confess our sins to him, he's faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. Verse 10. If we claim we have not sinned, we're calling God a liar and showing that his word has no place in our hearts. So there is one solution for sin. And it could be that you sin once or twice or many times. When Jesus said to Peter that we must forgive 70 times 7 times, he wanted to say, I forgive you infinitely. Even the same sin, if you do it over and over again, you do one thing. What is that? Confess your sin. And that's a hard thing to do. Not enough. How many of us pray like this? I know I do. Dear Father, forgive me for my sins. Does that work? I hope so, because there's ones that I'm not aware of that I'm sure that I have to cover with that blanket prayer. But to be honest, the proper confession is for me to say, forgive me for the way I spoke with Janelle yesterday. I said this, she said that, and I responded this way, and it was wrong. We didn't have a fight, by the way. We're good.
Yesterday.
The thing is, when we are confessing to God, it's just between us and God. And we're talking about exactly what that sin was. That's what he's talking about here. Not just glossing over it. Because if you gloss over it, well, you can just sort of pass by it really quick. When you speak with God about it, think about it. He already knows. He doesn't need you to tell him about the sin. He knows the sin. The purpose of this is for us to remember, for us to feel sadness and repentance. But then you get the other side of the coin here. Satan's job is to make us feel that that's all we're good for is sin. His job is to make us feel so overwhelmed and to make us feel like we shouldn't even bother coming to church. He's the one who wants us to think you're unworthy. He's the accuser. He's the enemy. Jesus is the helper. He's the forgiver. He's the reconciler. He's the one who unites. He's the one who loves. And he's the one who reaches out. And through John, Jesus is saying, I know you're a sinner. I know that you often are sinning the same sin. But each time you confess your sin, you are clean. And he is calling to us to feel clean and righteous and holy. He's not saying, you who have not sinned, come and partake of the communion. No, he's saying, you who have sinned, but wants to confess your sins and who wants to abandon the sin, come. Come to me. And the struggle to abandon sin is not ours. That struggle belongs to God. Our struggle is to stay connected to the vine. As long as we stay connected to the vine, God takes care of the rest. We have the struggle of the fellowship. As long as we're wolves, sin will dominate. The only change is when God takes that heart out and puts in a sheep's heart, and we turn into sheep and we actually become. And that is something God can do. We can't do that on ourselves. Now let's get back to preparing for communion. When we prepare for communion, there's a few prerequisites. I gave pretty much all these things already. One of them is we must understand what it's all about. We have to understand the solemnity of the occasion, the meaning, the purpose. And I recommend that everybody go read about this. Exactly what the recommendations of how to follow through and what it means. All the foot washing. Have you ever invite a friend from another church to the SDA church? You got to explain, well, we got this weird thing we do. We wash each other's feet. But all the other parts, just to understand and have the right attitude when we come. Another thing is we have to examine our heart. And I already talked about that. And our relationships with others. And finally, we have to deal with sin. We have to confess our sins. And then we partake with thanksgiving. Our final verse that I want to look at is the one we opened with. Let's look at the book of James. James chapter 4, and we'll look at verse 7 here. So humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. This is interesting. Resist the devil. That doesn't mean take up a sword and fight the devil. It actually, it's just resist it.